This is Marcus Hollinger, and this is the 116 Live Show on Holy Culture Radio, Sirius XM Channel 154.
All right, welcome to the 116 Life. My name is Marcus Hollinger. I'm your host, and I'm here with my good friend,
Ace Harris.
And this is the 116 Life on Holy Culture Radio, Sirius XM Channel 154. And today is one of them days.
Bro, go ahead.
Today is one of them days, man. We got the GOAT in the building.
Pretty much.
You know what I'm saying? We got the Mike Jordan of recording. You know what I'm saying? We got the forerunner. We got the guy in the bit. We got
the
president.
I feel like LBJ is a better sports analogy right now.
Oh yeah,
because he's been in the game for
still playing,
and still just won a chip 2-3 years ago.
Yeah, still doing it.
Still getting Grammy nominated.
Okay, so who we talking about though? We got Lecrae in the building.
Wow, guys, thank you.
Welcome, Lecrae.
Thank you.
This is. We had to get you in. We're grateful because you just got off the road.
That's right.
I mean, just touchdown. Yeah. You got European threads on coming back from your European trip, and then you're getting ready to bounce back out for the Church Close 4 tour, which we're excited to talk about today, unpack that a bit.
Yeah.
But first, Lecrae, I want to ask, as you just got off the college tour that you did with Hobie, just got back from Spain filming a movie.
That's right.
And you're getting ready to go out on tour for 20 plus dates with Elevation, Rhythm, and Dough. So I want to do a little check-in, Lecrae. Head, heart, gut.
Ooh.
Where is your head? Where is your heart? And what does your gut tell you you're going to experience out on this tour, Church Close 4?
Wow, that's a great question. Head, my headspace right now is basically thinking through, I think how to lend support, how to lend wisdom to younger up and coming artists, influencers, so on and so forth. I've just been looking for those type of opportunities, you know what I'm saying? And being on a road with a bunch of young artists gives me that opportunity. They're super talented too. So it's like, I like being ahead of the curve. I've taken people on the road with me before that just ended up out of there.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? And so I like being able to curate and find talent that people haven't really tuned into. Now, don't get it twisted. Doe's already got 4 Grammy nominations, but
right.
some people still don't know.
Right.
Yeah.
So it's like just, you know, Elevation, Rhythm, crazy talented.
Yeah.
People don't know. Heart. Man, I'm really grateful right now. You know what I'm saying? I'm just really grateful. I feel like God has just been very gracious to me, consistent, and I'm still here, bro. Like, I don't even understand how I'm still here. And so it's crazy. Gut, I feel like there's a change coming. You know what I'm saying? I don't know specifically what that is, but I feel like God is doing something, and there's a unique change on the rise, and I'm just trying to stay on board. Like whatever he's doing, I'm trying to be about that.
Can you speak a little bit more about the change that you see, like in music, culture, give me some context, help me understand.
Yeah, I think in general, you know, music, culture, we're in this era right now where, you know, artists are kind of curating, you know, via social media a lot, and that's where voices are being heard. But at the same time, you know, you have to figure out where you fit into that.
Yeah,
you know what I'm saying. And so, I feel like God is like, hey, be on deck because I need you for something.
Right.
But I don't know exactly what that is or how that plays itself out. You know what I'm saying? It's almost like, yo, Tom Brady, not saying I'm Tom Brady, but it's like, Brady, you about to come off the field, but be on deck because we got something different for you.
I love that analogy.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's great. And I wanna dive in a bit because there's a reason why Tom Brady came to mind when you kind of think about yourself, and then you even talk about, you know, what it means to come off the field. I'd love to hear, Cray, what does this, to me, you've been touring now for a long time, like 20 something years, yeah. You know, you've been touring. What does this tour represent in that lineup of what, of where you are now and what may come for you?
I mean, I'm a curator. That's yeah. really what I am. I would be a DJ or a producer if I wasn't an artist. I like curation. Mm-hmm. So this tour is big on curation. I think if anybody comes, they'll be pleasantly surprised. Like, dang, Cray put us on. Versus being like, I'm not really that familiar. What is this? Like, what is the idea here? What are you trying to do? I'm like, I'm trying to put you on.
Word.
You know what I'm saying? Okay. I'm trying to
Word.
Curate a situation for you.
Word.
You know, if you're a fan of what I do, you're going to have a great time regardless. But yeah. you also are going to be pleasantly surprised at the curation of music that I just put in front of you, because you wasn't really on it like that.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
That brings me to another question I want to ask. Like, you as a curator, which we've seen it like front row here. I guess historically, Christian hip hop artists tour with other Christian hip hop artists. Talk about like musically, sonically, like the landscape of why it's important for artists like you to kind of partner with, not just rappers in a tour setting. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. Yeah. I think it's important because I have a variety of listeners.
That's true.
That listen, that like come to me for different, I mean, for all intents and purposes, it's like a Drake or Kanye. They're rappers, mm-hmm. but they're more than rappers.
Yeah.
So you're not shocked if they are on the road with someone who's not a rapper, so to speak. And I think that's a little bit of what I bring to the table. Like, J. Cole is a rapper's rapper. So you almost expect rap to be on a tour.
Right.
Or at least something kind of adjacent.
Yeah, rap adjacent.
You know what I'm saying? But, you know, I've dabbled in, you know, pop stuff. I've dabbled in gospel. I've dabbled in just all kinds of different, you know, Afrobeat. You know
yeah,
what I'm
I mean,
saying?
You pretty much. I was talking to somebody about the other day.
Yeah,
like you've rapped or performed or recorded or expressed your voice in like every subgenre of hip hop. Every genre, like I've heard Lecrae on a pop track, a drill track, Afrobeat, boom bap, trap
Latin.
Record,
Latin.
Yeah,
I mean, you pretty much. I mean, yeah. So that spectrum makes sense when you think about having like Elevation, Rhythm, and Doe. I think it's dope to have. And I feel like, honestly, in Christian music, maybe you can speak to this too. I feel like we got to do better of cross-pollinating and always trying to silo the genres. Like, yo, this hip-hop is this youth thing. Stay over here.
Right.
This R&B thing is here. So, yeah, I mean, maybe that's something we can do more of. You know what I'm saying?
That's what I'm trying to do. Like, you know, is I just like putting people on, man, too. It's like there was a young artist named Ombre that I took out on the road, and she just, I seen her at the Rock Nation brunch, you know, just the other day.
On her own accord.
Yeah.
I love that.
You know what I'm saying? And so it's like, but people didn't know about her when we went on the road. You know what I'm saying? And so, you know, similarly now it's like Elevation Rhythm is like, you know, people look at them and like, oh, is this another kind of Maverick City type of vibe? Mm-hmm. And it's like, maybe there's some elements to that, but they also have some unique things. There's some international, you know, some artists are from South Africa. They got just different elements that they bring into the music.
That's true.
And then, of course, Doe does this unique blend of R&B and gospel. And it's just like, it's, if you are tapped in, you know. But if you're not, you will know.
You will know.
Yeah. And I love that. It's I remember when I recently found out about Doe. So I think you're hitting something. And I remember it was over Christmas. I was watching a video that she did with Israel Houghton, The Broken Things. And I mean, I was like, yo, the content of the song and just her performance, the way she showed up, it spoke to me. I think a lot to what Ace's point, when it comes to Christian music, we don't always anticipate that people need music for different things.
Right.
And I just love that more and more people are starting to say, you know what, I love the Lord and I want to be explicit in my music, but I know that there's multiple ways to serve people, and I'm going to go ahead and trust that expression versus trying to hit these buckets. That's kind of what I hear. And so you talked a bit about about curation and how you want to put people on. I would love to hear, Cray, if you could write the Yelp review of your of Church Close 4 right now, the ideal Yelp review, how would that come out?
Of the album?
Of the tour.
Of the tour. Oh, the Church Close tour? The Yelp review? I mean, of course, you know, Cray did exceeded the expectations exactly as I expected. And no glory to myself, but it's, you know, having people like Nate Robinson and Swoop.
Shout out Nate. Yeah. You know, shout out Swoop.
Having them help curate, even Michael V came in to help
Michael
curate the way the show is set up. And then, so I'm always going to take it there. I'm always going to challenge myself. You're getting basically like a new album. The way we're blending songs, I mean, you're getting something that no one's ever seen before. So, man, seeing a different aspect of this, hearing songs, yo, it's, I mean, the way, like, even with, like, I don't want to give it away, but, like, what we did with Hovey, with the walk song I got with Hovey, and what we did for the live performance of it is out of control. But then, you know, I got everything I wanted from Cray, but dag, he did not have to bless me with these two other groups.
Yeah.
That I be now became big fans of.
Yeah, yeah, you know, brother, so hit me upside the head.
Even like, as you're talking about putting a tour together with like your production team, bro, how hard is it to make a set list of like 20 years? Like how, for this tour, like how do you even start? Like, I'm just thinking about like as a fan.
Yeah.
I want this song. I want that song. Like, what's the challenge? And tell the people how do you figure that out?
So the upside is you've been on the road for so long, you know the ones that you have to play.
Okay.
Yeah.
So that's what we start with. We say what has to be played.
Okay.
And then you know you don't touch them. You just reimagine them.
Oh, that's dope. That's a dope bar.
Reimagine them. Like, all right, I gotta do this song. I'm personally tired of performing it. But let's reimagine it,
yeah,
so that it's exciting to me, which will then make it exciting to the viewer.
That's what I'm saying. Amazing.
Love that. You're touching on it a bit, but I want to hear Cray. I'm curious because the point of view or the perspective that you're talking about this tour, you're speaking about it from a pretty high level, from like a 30,000 foot view of like, yo, this is the experience I'm trying to give.
Yeah,
I'm curious. Is that always how you think about things? Is there something special about this tour that has you more in an architect? You sound more like an architect. Is there something about this tour that puts you in that seat?
Yeah, this is because there's a finality to it.
Oh, yeah.
You know what I'm saying? There's a finality to it. So you're not going to ever get this again. You know what I'm saying? Like, you're not going to get this level of curation from me on my tour. I may do shows in the future. I don't know if I'll ever do a whole tour again.
Whoa.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying?
That's big.
So I may do shows. You may catch me on, I don't know, you may catch me on someone else's tour, maybe. I don't know. But I don't know if I'll ever create another tour again. So there's a unique curation. So it's kind of like, hey, if you don't catch it, you didn't catch it.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? It's like, you missed it.
Yeah.
You know, not to say I'm retiring from music, but it's a lot of time and energy. You know, you got a family, you got other young artists you want to invest in, and being on the road is not beneficial for the type of investment that I want to do. So, you know what I'm saying? It's kind of like,
I hear what you're saying, but what I really heard was, y'all need to get y'all tickets for Church Close.
Yo,
tour.
Listen.
That's kind of what I heard. Like,
yeah, that's
this might be the one.
Yeah, let me. If not everybody has the gift of discernment, and not everybody has the gift of reading between the lines, so I'm just gonna retweet what A said. You need to get your Church Close for tour. You need to get your Church Close tour tickets because this is it.
Yeah,
you ain't getting this. You ain't getting this level again. You know what I'm saying? So tap in.
It ain't gonna happen.
And I love Lecrae what you're talking about in terms of the finality to this and some of the investments that you want to make. I love to get into that right after this break. So we're gonna take a quick break and we're gonna jump back in right there. For those of you who are just tuning in, this is the 116 Life, and my name is Marcus. I'm one of your hosts. I'm here with my homeboy
Ace Harris,
and we're broadcasting on Sirius XM Channel 154 on Holy Culture Radio. We're in studio with Lecrae talking about the Church Close tour, and we'll be right back after this break. We're going to hear some of this amazing kingdom building hip hop. Keep it locked. It's Holy Culture Radio. Okay, welcome back. If you're just tuning in, this is the 116 Life. I'm one of your hosts, Marcus, and I'm here with my good friend,
Ace Harris.
And this is the 116 Life on Holy Culture, Sirius XM Channel 154. Today is a very special day because we're joined with Lecrae. He's talking about the church clothes tour. He's talked about, he really dropped a bombshell on us earlier, and it bears repeating that this is it. So if you haven't already got those tickets to the church clothes tour, you need to go on and do that because you ain't going to see Lecrae like this again after
That's
this.
Right. It's called the final church clothes tour for a reason.
Yeah, it's a wrap. He's in his bag, and after this, he ain't, you know what I'm saying? You may get something different, but you ain't getting this bag. Lecrae, I would love to jump in, just kind of coming back on that and kind of touch on a little bit of what you said about the investments and things like that you're trying to make outside of touring. I want to touch on that, but I kind of want to step back real quick and just ask, what have been some of the keys to, because it's a bit of a privilege to be at this point in your career and start to think like that. So maybe we can spend some time reverse engineering. What have been some of the keys to building your touring business that has allowed you to get to this point?
Honestly, as a young artist, see, a lot of young artists have curated themselves via social media to look bigger than they are. So there's a hesitancy to look small when you're on the road. There's a hesitancy to want to pull up in a SUV and jump out in front of 60 people because you look so amazing on social media. But I didn't have that issue, and I didn't care. So I'm pulling up for 10 people in Oklahoma, and I'm giving them the show of their life. And guess what happens the next time I come to Oklahoma? It's 50 people. And then the next time I come to Oklahoma, it's 200 people. Because I wasn't worried about looking a certain way, for social media or whatever. You just can't be too proud to pull up, grimy. You know what I mean? It's like, man, we paid our dues. So I remember doing a Cross Women tour back in the day, like early 2000s, man. We had 4 SUVs through the West Coast.
Sheesh.
You know what I'm saying? I'm sleeping in an SUV, R Swift Drive, and I'm like waking up like, yo, we dead.
Man, shout out R Swift.
R Swift on the wheel, like going crazy.
Yeah, man. So you can't be too big for your britches. You got to be willing to just to do the small events, small shows, because they build. And once you build, it's like, man, you got a loyal fan base.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, speaking of building, like, talk to like what is something that that you did strategically. Obviously the grace of the Lord is on you, but to have a touring rap career is so like, it's such an anomaly, no pun. Right. Like, it's just, that's where you really win. What is something you did strategically, like whether it was music, business, curation, that was like, this helped me have like a 20-year touring career? Is there any one or two things you could think about?
Stop chasing the soft money. And when I say soft money, the soft money is like, we call them soft money, is like when you are not selling tickets. When you're selling a ticket, that's hard. That's hard ticket sale.
Yeah.
Right? Soft ticket is like when you go to a club or a church, and people start taking all of those gigs because sometimes they pay better, right? Because the church may have a built-in conference, and they're like, hey, we're gonna pay you, $15,000 to come out and be a part of this. Well, they coming for the conference. They're not coming for you.
Ooh.
And now the fans have, they got into the conference. Maybe it was free, right? Because it was at the church. So your fans are now used to not paying nothing to see you. So when you try to sell a ticket, they like, wait, I just saw you at this church conference for free. I'm not paying for you to perform. So you took all this soft money.
Right.
In the mainstream is clubs.
Club.
You know what I'm saying? They paying you club. Club, like, you pay to get in the club, and you just so happen to see the artist there.
Yeah.
In the Christian side, it's the church. It's churches. That's the soft money.
Church house, trap house.
Yeah, I mean, church house, trap house. So don't live by the soft money.
Right.
Get the hard ticket sales. Even if it means only 60 people showed up, you're building, you're telling a story, and over time, it will grow if you work on your show and make good music.
That's good. Yeah. That's good. You said something earlier, Cray, about showing up for 50, 60 people, giving them the time of their lives, and it reminds me of the first time I saw you live on Unashamed 5 tour. It was in Kansas City, my hometown, and your leg was broke.
Oh,
what man was remember that?
I was on the crutches, the Don't Waste Your Life tour.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The whole tour?
I tried to dunk on somebody. I had a hairline fracture on my ankle.
Yeah. Oh. But yeah. For me, it looked, all I saw was the cast.
Yeah.
And I was like, word, okay, I was new. By that time I was ingested in the music, so I could show up and I could sing, I could rap the records, but I hadn't really had exposure to the culture. I hadn't seen anybody live. First of all, when I was in that room, I was like, dang. Like, I was having my personal experience with the music. But when you came out and your joint, I was like, yo, because I've been to rap shows and you don't see rappers really like performing with their whole body. I mean, you was jumping around, you was doing the thing. And I'm curious. I mean, you've been doing this now for 20 years. What are some of the things that you do to maintain a healthy lifestyle so that you can continue to show up like that and continue to do that?
Yo, you don't realize that a healthy lifestyle benefits you on the stage. So the healthy lifestyle wasn't just for performing. It was because it was just me trying to live that way. Mm-hmm. But you don't realize how beneficial it is, because I remember, man, first I remember The Truth being on tour with him and he'd be on the treadmill rapping. And I was like, why are you doing that? He said, so I don't run out of breath. And I was like, oh, snap. I'm running out of breath every night rapping these lyrics. You know, better than any women in prison, descending to get a minute of any women in minute shooter. And so it's like, oh, let me get on a treadmill and build my endurance up.
Yeah.
Let me eat right so that I have energy night after night. Because, you know, once you hit 5 shows in a row,
oof,
your energy level just starts to go down.
Yeah.
And you can't, you know, I was consuming like energy drinks on a regular. It was just like not good for me.
Right. Yeah.
And I was destroying my body. So now, you know, I just try to take good care of my body, stay in shape.
Yeah.
So that I can keep doing it at the same level. Because I'm unfortunately, you know, I don't know how you want to look at it, I've always had a high energy show. So you go to a Kendrick or a Cole show, they can stay in one place.
Yeah.
Without having to jump, because they've built their show that way. People are used to my shows being at a 10.
Yeah, yeah.
So I can't come out there and try to be Jay-Z, Cole, or Kendrick all of a sudden.
Facts.
You know, I don't do what I used to do. I used to climb on speakers and do all that kind of crazy stuff. I don't do that no more. But yeah, man, I just in the gym, eat right, and try to keep it good.
Yeah. Have you ever had a show? Can you think of a recent or maybe even a memorable moment where you felt like you didn't give the show that you wanted to give?
Yeah, I mean, there's been plenty of times where I felt like I didn't give the show that I wanted to give. I think, honestly, like, the ones that are the more memorable, there was like a series on the Better Late Than Never tour where I was just kind of in a funk, you know what I'm saying? Mentally, emotionally, spiritually. And I think I remember reading the comments. And someone said, this is the best show ever. And I was like, I just kind of went through the motions and they thought it was the best show ever. Well, I'm doing that again tomorrow.
Oh, wow. Okay.
You know what I'm saying? And I just like went through the motions. And I remember like a series of shows where I was there, but I wasn't there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
So, yeah.
Yeah. But kind of to circle back to the question about betting on yourself, building your show. I have a question about the hard tickets thing, because I'm always intrigued by the business side of touring, especially being on the music side and the record side. Like, betting on yourself, selling hard tickets, what is the financial risk? And maybe you can speak to help people understand what goes behind in doing that.
Yeah.
Because it's easy to kind of get those steady, you know, club and church dates.
Right.
But what's the risk as a businessman that you took through the years to allow you to be here? You know what I'm saying?
I mean, you're investing in yourself, right? So every time... I think I'll just be candid because I can now.
Okay.
I went to see Kanye's Yeezus tour.
Okay, I was at the LA show for that one.
Right?
Yeah.
I said, this man spent $4 million every night to put this show on, and it gave some simulation of God, right? Like, it was like, and I thought to myself, people are impacted by this. And then I said, yo, he spent $4 million. I said, if he can spend $4 million to kind of allude to God, I can spend the bag to really give him Jesus.
Oof.
Yeah. So I, you know, was doing financially well. Anomaly was doing well. And I spent, not a night, but overall, I spent $1 million on that tour.
Whoa. Yeah.
Anomaly, right?
Yeah, Anomaly tour.
That tour was crazy.
Amazing.
Spent $1 million because I knew every night the word of God was going forth. People was going to hear Jesus and lives would be impacted. So I spent $1 million to put that tour together. I did not make $1 million back, right? It was an L financially.
Oh, wow.
Right?
Didn't know that.
So it was a financial L after you paying bills. I mean, yes, we probably
revenue
over $1 million.
Right, gotcha.
But
yeah.
Profit? Nah, I probably made 20 grand.
Dang.
Whoa, that math ain't math then. If you just,
I spent $1 million and made $20,000. But for me, it was an investment. It was an investment in people. It was an investment in the brand. It was an investment in the music and the experience. And since that tour, people was like, yo, I got to make the next tour.
Man, see, that's what I'm saying. And it's crazy, Cray, to sit here and hear about that. Because so many people are familiar with they only get to know an artist through the records, right?
Yeah.
Like, okay, what you say or don't say in your music, right? Things like that. But to hear, this was an investment. You put $1 million of your own bread up to invest in people. And just that thought process, I'm like, yo, man, I hope y'all listening to this, man. I really hope y'all hearing what Lecrae is putting into his career. And on the investment side, I want to kind of circle back to this lifestyle thing. What are some things, because you're also a husband, you're also a father and things like that, and you have been touring and things. So I would love to ask, how are you maintaining, or how have you maintained a lifestyle that also, you know, kind of as you're investing in your career, you're investing and maintaining, keeping your head at home and things?
I mean, it's some of it's trial and error. Some of it is trying to keep an idea of what you want in front of you. I will say this. I have been beautifully traumatized by not having my father in my life. So it constantly puts a mile marker in front of me to not ever be passive in terms of being a father. I grew up with a single mother, so there's a mile marker in front of me of, you know, wanting to take care of a woman who's working hard, and you know what I'm saying, when it comes to my wife. You know, I don't do it perfectly by any stretch of the imagination, but that trauma, you know, God gave me beauty for ashes. And to where I'm like, I don't know what I'm doing, so I'm constantly learning. I did not have a dad in the house to show me nothing. So I'm like, I got to read a book. I got to learn. I got to figure this out, you know. Whereas, you know, for some people who aren't traumatized that way, they know what to do. It's not a stress for them. This is just life. What do you mean you don't eat dinner with your kids? That's what we do. You know what I'm saying? That's how my wife grew up. They ate dinner together.
Man,
I ate dinner, you know, watching television. Everybody was in, you know. So for me, it's like, all right, I'm working on it intentionally. And sometimes I don't do it right, but it's always an intentional mile marker in front of me.
Love that, man. I think that's a great place for us to talk about what comes next for you. But we're going to take a break real quick. If you're just tuning in, my name is Marcus. I'm one of your hosts. I'm here with my good friend
Ace Harris.
And this is the 116 Life on Sirius XM Channel 154, Holy Culture Radio. We're joined today by Lecrae talking about the Church Coast Tour. We're going to get right back into it after this break. Stay locked for this amazing Christian hip hop. Some of the best artists doing it. Keep it locked. It's Holy Culture Radio. Welcome back. This is the 116 Life. My name is Marcus, one of your hosts, and I'm here with my good friend
Ace Harris.
And this is the 116 Life on Holy Culture Radio, Sirius XM Channel 154. And today is a special day.
Today is a good day.
Because we got Lecrae in the building.
Hey.
giving us the low on the Church Close tour. Yes, thank you for being here with us, Cray. This has been a great conversation. We've been talking about curation. We've been talking about the business of touring and all of that. And so now we want to get into a bit about, let's talk about the music and how the music relates to the tour. So you just dropped the Dry Clean Only
edition of
Church Clothes, and this is it. So right. I would love to hear, how are you feeling about touring those records and picking the ones that, how are you thinking through picking the one? And we talked a bit about you pick the hits, but this, particularly this, is there a record out of this, the batch, that you're excited to perform?
Oh gosh, some records surprise you because you don't realize the way people are going to respond to them. So the sleeper for me is Dirt on Church Close 4. When it's performed live, people go crazy. I'm like, oh, I didn't know y'all was going to rock. Because it's not like a top streamer.
Right.
But it's similar to Being Broke Made Me Rich. It's not a big streaming record, but it's a big concert record.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so some records
do better live than they actually perform on streaming. So I think that's going to be dope, but it's the blend of like some of the music. I think Deconstruction is going to be powerful, of course.
That's a long verse.
It is.
A lot of words.
It is.
You been on that treadmill? You're going to have some wind for that
one. I think that'll be powerful. You know, maybe being able to pull up in St. Louis and maybe, you know, Tori Deshawn get up and we can do Price Up. That might be a vibe.
Nice.
That'd be hard.
You know what I'm saying?
That'd
that might be a vibe. Hard. But yeah, man, it's gonna be fun. I'm excited. The curation part is always fun when you can reimagine and you can just brainstorm and create.
Yeah, something. I mean, speaking of Church Close 4, I mean, obviously the music inspires the tour in the moment.
Yeah.
Marcus asked earlier to write a Yelp review on the tour. Objectively, as much as you can, what's the Yelp review on the Church Close 4 project, including the Dry Clean Only series? What's your like Yelp review? Lecrae to himself, you know.
It's kind of funny because I don't spend a lot of time on what I've done. I tend to move on. Anybody who's working with me knows.
No, boy. You have to sit in it for a minute. No, hey boy. After release day on Monday morning.
You know
what's next, y'all?
Man. So I'm always shocked at the after effect. I'm always like, oh, y'all was rocking with it like that. I'm already on this.
Nah.
And so, like, I had so moved on. You know, when Dry Clean Only dropped, I'm shooting a movie.
That's
and
true.
I'm thinking about these new songs that I just got in. So I'm not even thinking about Dry Clean Only. And then people start hitting me like, yo, what? Why is this deluxe? These should have been on the project. And I'm like, dang, I didn't. D-Smoke hit me like, bro, this body of work is crazy. Thank you for having me be a part of this. And I'm like, let me go back and listen to this. You know what I'm saying? So, yeah, man, it's kind of wild.
It's funny sometimes working with you, people be like, man, y'all, how do y'all stay on your toes, all this stuff, and the cat's out the bag is because we have to.
Lecrae gonna keep you on them toes.
Lecrae is that guy that's gonna be like, yo, we just won a championship ring. He's like, yeah, but I was looking at my shooting percentage and I was a 31, but at the height of my career, I was actually a 42. So how can we work on my shooting percentage?
Shooting practice on Monday morning.
Yeah, shooting practice on Monday morning. We're gonna get just, you know, and it's like, all right, Batman, cool. You
know, I think there's something special, and you can speak to this too. Well, Lecrae, you're very like, you're an artist who is very you share the music, like you give it away. Mm-hmm. And I think sometimes artists, they hoard the art in a way where it's hard for people to engage it. You're very like giving of the music, giving of the tour moments. And like, what is it about you that makes that so like easy for you to kind of just be freely giving of the music and the art, you know?
Yeah, I'm unique as an artist. I'm more like a DJ. I'm more like a curator. I get excited about the response to the music more than I get excited about the curation of the making of it. You know what I'm saying? So some people get in the weeds making it. I get in the weeds trying to figure out what people want to hear. You know what I'm saying? So I'm like, let's hit them with this one. Putting out music is one big club event for me. I'm just DJing a festival when I put out music. So I'm like, let's see how this hit them. It was cool. Hit them with this one. They rocking with this one. All right, what else we got in the bag like this to get that same, elicit that same response? So
that's crazy.
It's more of that kind of mentality. As I'm creating music, it's like, man, what can I, and not just to get them excited, but whatever emotion that I'm trying to, it's like, yo, people need to feel loved. Restoration came from me seeing what was going on with my sis Aisha Curry and like her needing to feel embraced and not shunned for her perspectives. It's like, I want people to feel that. It's, you know, whatever emotion I'm trying to get from people is why I'm curating the music. So I don't know, man. Like, I'm just not built like that. I'm not the type of person that's like, I gotta just keep tweaking away until, and maybe I'll let them hear it.
That's super dope.
That's dope. And I one thing I want to ask, just in terms of that, Cray, and we know that you are, you know, if this is 2023. What year are you in right now mentally, and what are you excited about? And if you're in 2025 and you're excited about something, what is it?
I think the thing, what I'm learning, and this is where God keeps challenging me. What I'm learning is that I'm learning that there's still room to be excited. There's still room to be surprised. And I think God is reminding me of that. Cause I think I was thinking specifically like after restoration, I'm not gonna lie to you. Like just candidly, I thought after everything I went through with All Things Work Together and you know, the social political climate, I really thought I was done.
Man.
So I thought I was done. And if I wasn't done, I thought the people were done. You know what I'm saying? So I was like, don't nobody want to hear no music from me no more. I just had a warped perspective living in my own little bubble. And then, you know, Restoration goes on and, you know, has these big records and gets nominated for a Grammy. And I'm like, what? Okay. That's kind of crazy. And then you put out, I'm like, yeah, well, you know, maybe this Spread the Ops is a bass hit. You know, this might be cool. And then it's like, no, that was a good song. Like, you know what I mean? It's like, oh.
Yeah.
So there's still room to be surprised. I be feeling like, man, there's nothing left. Like, because the class of folks I came in the game with, nobody wants to hear from them no more. So I'm always shocked that people are still invested, engaged, and interested. I came in the game. I mean, think about who came in the game in 05, 04, 05. Who's still here?
Yeah.
We're going to leave them names off the record. They're going to be in your DMs.
But I'm not even on the Christian side. I'm talking about
them in general. Yeah.
Like, nice. Who came in the game during that time period? And it's like,
yeah, there's some names.
There's a whole roll call.
I'm still shocked that people are interested in hearing from me, and God keeps surprising me.
So that makes me think of something that you said earlier. You talked about the wisdom and the soft tickets versus the hard tickets and how you built out your business. Cray, if you had to reverse engineer your own career, why do you think it is, or what factors do you think have contributed to people wanting to still hear from you?
When I reverse engineer it, I mean, I obviously, you know, God is a big factor in it. But what I think happened is you had an artist who was creating very authentic music from a very authentic place. It was resonating with the community and culture that I created it for. It got picked up by a broader musical genre, you know, via CCM.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? And I became a staple within the CCM culture when I wasn't trying to be, but it was like, hey, you know, you became somebody in our space and now we are tapped in. And then they was just riding with me as well. And when a lot of people in that genre were kind of like, well, yeah, he's old news, we're done with him, there was still this fan base that you had curated, that you had spoken to all these years.
Yeah.
That you never let go.
Yeah.
You know, even if you got as big as Flo Rida,
okay,
you still made those songs
for them.
The core.
The core. Yeah.
You
deep,
never
deep
left
in.
Them. You know what I'm saying? And so when the radio not messing with you no more, the radio being CCM, the core is like, we still here, bro.
Yeah.
You never left.
Yeah.
You know?
I love that. So, what I hear in that is you saying that you were intentional to pay attention to who you were making music for. And despite who came on board, you continued to serve them so that when the larger crowd went away, you still had people there.
Yep.
And if we could consolidate as a gym for other artists, it's like, man, focus on building a fan base.
That's right. That's
right. Like, you can chase the hits and things like that, but
That's right. You know, but
you want to build a fan base and you want to build your fundamentals.
That's right.
And especially in our space, Cray, let me ask you this as a follow-up, because we do see that happen sometimes where artists are actually doing the opposite.
Mm-hmm.
They'll say, man, you know what? I ain't messing with y'all no more. Leave me alone.
Mm.
Like, there are artists.
You say messing with y'all?
The core.
Their core. Or say if they started out with a Christian core.
Okay, I was trying to, yeah.
And then they've gained a broader audience.
Right.
And the Christian core or their core fans saying like, hey, man, we had this expectation. And they'll say in rougher terms than I'm willing to say on this show, I'm not worried about y'all no more. I'm
right.
over here.
Right.
How would you speak to that, or what do you think is going on? We can never unpack somebody else's intentions, but what do you think about that trend? It seems like a newer trend.
Yeah, I think people, you know, end of the day, you just get caught up in reading your own press clippings. It ain't nothing but pride. You know, I think of the story in the scriptures of Naaman, and he was a man of the soil. He got his hands dirty. He was about the people, and then he just grew. He started winning battles, and it was like, yo, I'm that dude.
Yeah.
And it's like, then he starts to walk inside to the temple of the Lord. Like, hey, you don't belong in here. And it's like, man, move out the way. All right. And now you're cursed. You know what I'm saying?
Oh, snap.
And that's really what I see happening over and over again with artists, is they get so wrapped up in themselves and narcissistic, they get beyond the people. And then they quit caring about the folks who put them in the position that they're in.
That's good.
And then they bump their head and they have nowhere to run. You know what I'm saying? You got no fan base to run to. So, but it's a delicate tension too. It's a delicate balance of like, you're the fans that came in the game with you, they want a certain sound from you, but you have to transcend where music
is
as well. You can't keep giving them that same sound forever, because you're going to be left with 8 fans because people have moved on.
Okay.
So you got to like take them with you incrementally.
Yeah.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying?
Dope.
And that's what I try to do, is take them with me.
Yeah, Tadashi touched on this a little bit. It sounds like there's a bit of back and forth, right? Because you want to bring them with you, but you also want to make sure to pay attention to where they're going.
Right.
So that neither one of y'all kind of get left. And it's
right.
like, you're moving ahead, I'm moving ahead, I'm moving ahead, I'm bringing you with me.
Right.
It's a balance.
Absolutely.
What I hear.
Yeah, that's
super
dope, man.
It's a tension. And so, you know, it's going to be... Yeah, and then, you know, I'll just get, you know, for me as an older artist.
Who looks 25?
Yeah, but I mean, to keep the audience that started with me, you know, engaged, they get songs that still speak their language. They may, the production may be updated. So a journey or a deconstruction, you know, that's for the folks who've been here for a minute. But then for a younger audience, man, you don't just change your sound. You got to be tapped into their world. And so, you know, I always work with younger artists as well, because they look at it, they think I'm helping them, but they're helping me too, right?
Ooh, yeah.
I'm helping them by giving them advice, you know, stamping them with like, yo, you are really dope and I know I've achieved all this and I'm showing you love, but you're also helping me because I'm gleaning and learning like what's happening in this younger artist culture, and I'm able to stay afloat and understand what's, you know what I'm saying? And so I remember NK4 heard me on a song with Miles Minnick, and he was like, I'll never doubt you again. He was like, I did not know you was going to be able to tap into like the youth West Coast rhyme patterns.
Yeah.
and it's like, man, it's from being tapped in with the youngins.
Yeah, man. I love that. And speaking of that helping and being helped out. We're getting ready to come up on our time for today. But Cray, I want you to help our listeners who may not understand the pressing nature of why they need to get these church clothes
tickets.
Help them out, Cray. Why do they need to move right now?
Number one, because you're not going to see this again. I'm just being honest. I cannot tell you honestly like when I'm ever going to put together my own tour again. It's just a lot of work, a lot of time, a lot of energy, and I'd like to dedicate my energy to a lot of other things. So that's one. Number two, it's been a lot of curation that's gone into this. So we put a lot of time and energy into it. And number three, man, you're going to see some new and unique artists that I promise you're going to be a fan of when you leave. You know what I'm saying? You're going to be a fan when you leave. So, you know, make sure you tap in. And if the tickets are sold out, go to the next city. You know what I'm saying?
Just like that. It's okay to travel somewhere you ain't never been.
Take a little road trip.
Road trip.
You know what I'm saying?
Get your crew.
Yeah. Well, Cray, we appreciate you. For those listening, you can go right now to Lecrae.com. Man has made it very easy.
That's right.
Very simple for you. Lecrae.com. Grab your tickets for the church clothes tour.
That's right.
And we'll see you out there. If you're in Atlanta, you could tap in. You know, I might make a little trip myself to Kansas City. You know what I'm saying?
Let's go. Okay,
so y'all travel, I'm traveling, we traveling, and we'll see you there. Thank you, Cray. For those just tapping in, we've been sitting there with Lecrae talking about the church clothes tour for 116 Life. Signing out, my name is Marcus.
I'm Ace Harris.
And this is the 116 Life on Holy Culture Radio, Sirius XM Channel 154. We'll be tapping in with y'all next week.